Hello everyone, welcome to our final session of Biblical Foundations 2. I hope you've been learning a lot, and especially during this time of crisis, I hope you are all safe, you're all well, and healthy of course, and most of all, I pray that you are growing even more in your love for God, and hopefully these sessions really help you know more about Jesus, know more about His love, know more about, of course, what He has done for you and for me. So as we close this series, this Biblical Foundations 2, let's first have a recap of the things that we have learned. So we started first with the assurance that we are saved, that God has given us a promise, assuring us that if we place our faith in Him, we have salvation. We have eternal life, there is forgiveness, we are part of His family. Of course, we are a new creation. We can live for Him. We can honor Him. And in the second week, we talked about the basis of our salvation. Yes, it's free, but someone had to pay for it. There's a cost, and that is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And then last week, we talked about why sin is bad. Why is this our greatest problem? And why did God send His Son to die for your sins and my sins? And today, as we close this series, we're going to talk about saving faith. Why is this an important topic? Because some people could just say, you know, I have faith in God, but it's not actually saving faith. There is that kind of faith that is biblical, that God wants, that God requires, and those people who have this kind of faith are saved. So it doesn't mean that if you just say, okay, I believe, that's it. It should be a genuine kind of faith. Because some people, sad to say they're Christians, they say they believe, but in their heart of hearts, they're not genuine. It's not a genuine kind of faith. We are not to judge who those people are, but we are to evaluate our lives. Do I have that kind of faith? Do I have a saving kind of faith? Let's look at some of these verses, why this faith is very important. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, let's read this together. It says here, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without this genuine faith that our Lord Jesus Christ requires, that our Heavenly Father requires, it's impossible to please Him. For he who comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who seek Him. And it's not just that. In Romans chapter 5, verse 1, therefore, having been justified. I like that word, because the word justified means we are not guilty, we are declared righteous. It's like a judge saying, you're not guilty, your sins or your mistakes have been paid for, you are now free to go. We have been justified by what? By faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. If we placed our faith in Him, a genuine kind of faith, the saving kind of faith, then we are justified and we have peace with God. And look at this passage in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 to 9. And I know you've read this many times, but let's read this together. For it is by grace, it's the grace of God, you have been saved. And this grace through faith, our faith in the Lord. And this is not from ourselves, it is the gift of God. Even our faith is a gift from Him. Not by works. It's not because we did something that's why we're saved. It's because of what He has done and we placed our faith in Him. So it's not by works, so no one can boast. So in other words, if we're going to look at a formula of salvation, and I know some of you have seen this, but just a recap, this is the formula of salvation. Faith in Jesus plus what? Nothing. Say that with me. Nothing. Faith in Jesus plus nothing equals salvation. The gift of God, of eternal life. We are saved because of our faith in Jesus plus nothing. Where's the good works? Resulting. That's the arrow there. Resulting to good works. In other words, if I genuinely place my faith in Jesus, it will result to good works. Good works didn't save me. Good works was they're not the reason why I'm going to heaven. It's because of my faith in Jesus. It's because of what He has done. And I placed my faith on what He has done. And because of my faith in Him, of course, if it's genuine, it will result to obedience. And if it's not genuine, then there's no good works. There's no obedience to the Lord. Can you look at your family members with you? Can you just check if that person is obeying the Lord? Again, we're not here to judge people. But again, this is a very important topic because it's for us to evaluate. Do I have this kind of saving faith that God wants me to have? You see, saving faith is biblical kind of faith. It's a biblical kind of faith. So what does this mean? What does this mean in the passages that we've read? Let's look at Hebrews 11 verse 6 again. So it reads here, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to Him, if we're going to come to Him in faith, must believe that He is really God, that He is our Savior and Lord, and that He exists, and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. Do you see the picture here that God wants to bless us? God wants to bless people. But a lot of people don't genuinely believe. So what does this mean? Let's look at the next slide. Biblical faith means that it is a sincere trust and commitment that result in what? Obedience. Sincere. It's from the heart. It's genuine. It's not fake. Sincere trust and commitment that result in obedience. It's just like this. When you're sick, you have a favorite doctor to go to. Some of you, right? Let's say you're sick with cough or with fever. I'm not talking about COVID-19, okay? But the usual kind of flu. Or maybe you have bone problems. You have a favorite doctor already that you go to. And most of the time, or if not all the time, whatever that doctor says, you're gonna obey. You're gonna follow. If the doctor says, put hot compress. If the doctor says, take this medicine. Let me ask you, do you know what's inside that medicine? Maybe some of the ingredients you know, but you don't know completely. Do you know how it really works? Maybe sometimes you know because your doctor explained, but you cannot fully comprehend it. Do you know why he said this or that? Most of the time, we don't know. But why do we believe? Because we have faith that the doctor is saying what's right. That's the kind, if we have that kind of faith to a doctor who's imperfect, why don't we have that kind of faith sometimes, or for some people who are listening, why don't we have that kind of faith to God, to Jesus, who died and rose again? Another thing, for example, let's say you're a businessman and you have some business concern. Some of you go to a certain businessman who's really good, who's an expert in business. And whatever that person says, you believe. Let's say the person says, oh, you invest here, or you do this, or you pay this kind of amount, or you go to this kind of business. If you really believe in this kind of in this businessman, usually whatever that person says, we obey. That's the kind of faith that God wants us to have in Him. It's a sincere faith that, okay, yes, I believe you. Yes, I trust you. Yes, I know what you're saying is right. Therefore, I'm going to obey. You see, our problem is this. Our problem is some trust in Jesus and other things for our salvation. That's a big problem. Some trust in Jesus and they add. Not just in this country, but even all over the world. They couldn't just accept what Jesus Christ has said. That for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son. That whoever believes, and there's no end. Whoever believes shall not perish but have everlasting life. But for some people, this is what they think. Whoever believes, I believe in Jesus, and I know I need to do this. I need to go to church always. I'm not saying don't go to church, but some people look at going to church as a means to salvation. Some people look at giving tithes as a means to salvation. Some people look at helping other people, helping the poor, giving to those who are in need as a means to salvation. Salvation is only by faith. In the work of God, in what He has done for you and for me. That's saving faith. Another problem that we have is this. Some believe that there are other ways to salvation because God is the God of love. And that's why we have biblical foundations too. Because here, it somehow clarifies that, hey, God is yes, the God of love, but He's also the God of just. That's why there was a cost for our salvation. The blood of Christ. We have to understand that the penalty of sin is really death. That's why Jesus Christ came here. You know, this was years ago. I remember watching this episode. Somebody just sent this link. Oprah interviewing some ladies, and then they were debating that there are many ways to heaven. And then there's this girl who's a solid Christian saying, no, only Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only way. He's the only, believing in Him, trusting in Him. But Oprah, since it was her show, saying, no, if you find love or whoever you call God in loving this person or in this kind of religion or in this kind of belief system, then you're saved. I believe you're saved. Some people adhere to that kind of belief. And that's very problematic because Jesus said He's the only way, truth, and life. That's why point number two of biblical faith. Biblical faith has a proper object. Our faith has an object. Like what I said earlier, you and I have favorite doctors, right? When we're sick, our faith goes to that person. We go to the person because we believe in that person. It has an object. And the object of our faith, the saving kind of faith, should be Jesus Christ. Not Jesus Christ plus something, not other ways to go to heaven or to get salvation. No, the object is Jesus Christ alone. And yes, it's exclusive. And some people don't like to hear that. Some people say that, why is God very exclusive, that there's only one way? Because there's only one way. Only Jesus Christ died and rose again. Only He can offer salvation. Nobody else can offer that. That's why look at the some people, what their object of their faith is. It cannot be another person. It cannot be. The object of our faith cannot be another person. And whether that person is historical, somebody from the past who did something amazing, or a religious figure. And some people, they put their faith on a religious figure. If it's not Jesus Christ, that's not going to save. If it's not Jesus Christ, it's never going to work. The object of our faith cannot be good works. And some would say that, you know, I'm a good person. I've done some, you know, if I look at my life, maybe 70% are good things and 30% are evil things. But relatively, I'm better than the others. No, because we believe that everybody sinned. And because of our sin, the wages of that is death, right? And the object of our faith cannot be church or religion. It cannot be because church is imperfect. Religion is imperfect. It's just a set of rules for us to follow. But rules without relationship with Jesus Christ is not genuine kind of faith. The object of our faith also cannot be love. Just like what what Oprah in her show said. That it's okay as long as you learn to love people. As long as you're loving one another. As long as you're positive in life. No, it will never, never, ever work. Because if there are many ways, then why did Jesus have to come here? If there are other ways to go to heaven, to be saved. If there are other ways to pay for the penalty of our sin. Then why did Jesus have to die at that cross? Because the penalty of sin is death. Someone had to pay for that. And only Jesus has the authority. And the perfect sacrifice is only our Lord and Savior Jesus. And the object of our faith cannot be Jesus plus. Just, that's why our formula earlier. Faith in Jesus plus nothing equals salvation. And if it's genuine, it will result to good works. Now let's look at this passage. For God so loved the world, John 3:16, that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall what? Not perish, but have eternal life. There's no other way. The object of our faith is Jesus Christ. And in John chapter 5, verse 24, I tell you the truth, whoever hears My word, this is Jesus saying, speaking, and believes Him who sent Me, has eternal life. It didn't say there, as long as you love, as long as you do good. I'm not saying don't do good. In fact, if we love God, we will do good. But in order to be saved, Jesus Christ clearly points it out. Whoever hears my word, believes him who sent me, has eternal life, will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. And in John 11, 25, 26, last week, a few weeks ago, we remembered, celebrated the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And this is what he said to Martha. He said in verse 25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. So all the kind of death here, as long as you're in Christ, are temporary kind of death. Because whoever lives and believes in me, Jesus saying, will never die. And that's why he asked Martha, do you believe this? And in John 14, 6, we mentioned this earlier. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I mean, these verses really proves that salvation is only in Jesus Christ. It's very exclusive. That's why a lot of people are not comfortable with this. Because for a lot of people nowadays in this world, they want it inclusive. They want to include everyone. Whatever your belief system is, as long as you're a good person, you're going to go to heaven. It cannot be like that. That will never work. That's why Jesus Christ came here. To say to the world, no, there's only one way. That's why he proved it. He died and he rose again. He's the only religious figure who says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. He's the only one who said that. And he pulled it off. Because again, that's why we have the Resurrection Sunday. That's why we have the Easter, the Holy Week, to remember what he has done. And not just his death, but that he rose again. He proved that he is God and what he's saying is true. Now, what about the Old Testament? You might be saying, okay, for us, after the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, he rose again, we place our faith in him. But what about in the Old Testament? Did they have faith? Of course. Let's look at this verse. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, he hasn't seen any flood in the past, but he was warned, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. Holy fear, a reverent kind of fear. By his faith, there you go, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. The righteousness that comes by faith. Declared righteous because of faith. Declared not guilty because of faith. Yes, Noah was a sinful person, but look at the description about him. In Genesis chapter 6, this is the account of Noah. Noah was a righteous man because of his faith, not because he was doing certain good things. Yes, he was blameless among the people. He's not perfect, but he's a good person. He was blameless, righteous among the people of his time. He walked with God. It's because of his faith. That's why he's living a life of obedience. How do we know that he has faith? Hebrews chapter 11 pointed that out. And not just that. Look at the next verses in Genesis chapter 6. Now the earth was corrupt. We know this story. In God's sight, and was full of violence. That's why God saw how corrupt the earth had become. For all the people on the earth had corrupted their ways. They were not following God. They were doing evil things. Only Noah and his family was righteous. So God said to Noah, I am going to put an end to all people. You know, some people, when they read something like this, they're going to be shocked. Because they will see how just God is. That he is holy. And when there's evil, he destroys it. So let's continue reading. I'm going to put an end to all people. For the earth is filled with violence because of them. I am surely going to destroy both them and the earth. Grabe naman to si Lord. I thought God is loving. But again, he's love and he is just. Where is his love here? Let's go on and let's continue with the story. I'm going to bring flood waters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens. Every creature that has the breath of life in it, everything on earth will perish. And it actually happened. But where's God's love? Do you know that after he said this, he commanded Noah, okay, I want you to build an ark. So this requires a lot of faith. You know why? Because one, it's his first time, Noah's first time to build an ark. So God guided him. So God told Noah, make an ark according to God's specification, 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, 45 feet high. How will you be able to do that? It's just you and your family. That's very difficult. Where are you going to get the wood? Of course, there are so many trees there, but how will you be able to do this? And then you're going to enter the ark, you and your sons and their wives, and then not just that, you are to bring two or more of every living thing into the ark. How will you be able to do that? How will you be able to convince a lion to go inside? Of course, it was God's power that made them go there, but still, it was by faith. He didn't know that what's going to happen. He just obeyed the Lord and built the ark. And then eventually, you will bring food for his family and also for the animals. Imagine for all the animals there, how will you know what kind of food to feed these animals? How will you know they're not going to harm you? It's by faith. He trusted the Lord. He didn't understand completely what's going to happen, but he obeyed the Lord by starting to build the ark. Do you know how long it took him to build the ark? How long did it take Noah to build the ark? 120 years. That's quite long. It's one thing to obey God for a month. It's one thing to obey God maybe for a year. But for 5 years, 10 years, for 120 years, we need faith. We need to trust God that what He's saying is true, and that he exists, and he is a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. That's why Noah placed his faith on God. And why did it take that long? Look at 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 20, it reads, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah. Why did he wait patiently in the days of Noah? While the ark was being built, in it, only a few people, 8 in all, were saved through water. Why did he wait patiently? You know why? Because he wanted people to be saved. How do we know? In 2 Peter chapter 2, if he did not spare the ancient world when he brought the flood on its ungodly people. Yes, he did that. But he protected Noah. What was Noah's role during that time? While he was building the ark. A preacher of righteousness. And 7 others. His family. In other words, he preached the good news to them, the warning, of course, to them, and the good news that God wants to save them. They are to repent, they are to believe in God, but nobody repented. Only Noah and his family were saved. So God gave them a chance. He waited patiently. That's where his love is. He waited patiently. He didn't send the flood right away. He could have done that. Send the flood right away and everybody wiped out except Noah and his family. But no, he wanted Noah to build the ark. He wanted Noah to preach the good news and the warning and the good news to the people. The warning that there's going to be a flood and the good news that God is the God who loves. That Yahweh is the one who will save us. So trust Yahweh. But they were just laughing at Noah. They were just maybe making fun of him. Why are you building an ark? There's no rain. It's not going to flood here. We're far away from the nearest shore. You see, when God tells us to do something that doesn't make sense, let me ask you, do you believe in Him? Do you really have genuine faith in Him? When God tells you to let go of that, to do this, to tell people about Him, to love Him, to read His Word, to obey Him, to honor Him, to honor your authorities and not bash them online, will you step in faith? Or will you trust your own ways? You see, Noah had faith in the Lord. And that faith led him to obey God. So what does this teach us about saving faith? Let's look at Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. It reads here, trust in the Lord with what? All your heart. And lean not on your own understanding. I love that phrase. Trust in the Lord with all. That's saving kind of faith. It's the belief that, Lord, I trust you with my life. I cannot save myself. I need you, Lord God. I need you. I cannot save myself. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. It means three things. Number one, believe. Believe that the basis is God's word. It's not our feelings. That's faith. Or our own understanding. That's why it says, lean not on your own understanding. You know, the crazy thing about this, trusting God's word, is sometimes it goes against our understanding. Because our understanding is limited. This is what we see. That's why I hear people, when God is telling them to let go of this, or don't do that, or don't do this evil practice with your business, or don't treat your spouse like that, some people just couldn't accept it because it goes against their understanding. For them, they view it like this. But this is what I feel is right. But this is what I think will work. But not everything that we feel is right is good for us. Not everything that we think will work will actually work. That's why trust the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Believe that God's word, this is the basis of our faith. It's not our feelings. Because if we base our faith on our feelings, I tell you, there will be times we don't feel like believing. A lot of times we don't feel like trusting. But if we trust His word and it is the truth, and we believe it's the truth, and we believe that this will guide us, it's a lamp to our feet, a light to our path, then He said He's going to lead us to the straight path. Second thing that it means, or it teaches us not just to believe, but belief that leads to obedience. It is not enough that we know, we need to act on God's word. Because sad to say, there are Christians who know a lot about God's word, but it's not in their heart. And when it's not in their heart, it doesn't go out in action. We need to believe it not just in the head. We need to trust in it completely. And trust, believing in His word, will lead to obedience. The genuine kind of faith leads to obedience. And it doesn't just lead to obedience, it also leads to proclamation. What do I mean by that? We may expect the world to laugh at us, but we still need to warn them of God's impending wrath and the reality of hell. And we need to tell them about the love of God. Yes, that God is just, then He punishes sin, but He is also a loving God, and He paid for that penalty. We need to proclaim this word, the truth, because a lot of people are lost, you know, especially during this time. Because some people are holding on to the wrong things. Some people are still holding on to money. Some people are still holding on to other people. Some people are holding on to a wrong belief system, a wrong kind of object of their faith, and it will not save them. That's why, just like Noah, we need to step in faith. Because in Genesis chapter 6, this is what happened. Only Noah and his family were saved. I'm going to bring flood waters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens. Every creature that has the breath of life in it, everything on earth will perish. And every living thing in chapter 7, on the face of the earth was wiped out. That's what happened after the flood. Men and animals and the creatures that move along the ground and the birds of the air were wiped from the earth. Only who? Noah was left. And those with him in the ark. And guess what? This was the judgment during Noah's time. In 2 Peter chapter 3, Peter warns us that there's also going to be a judgment. Let's read this. In verse 3, first of all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come. People who will mock God, who will mock the gospel, scoffing and following their own evil desires. What will they do? What will they say? They will say, where is this coming? The coming of the Messiah that they promised, or the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Ever since our fathers died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. Everything seems normal. Well, now in our time, it seems not normal. But some would say, if this goes back to normal, then people, some may say that, oh, I thought the second coming is about to happen, but it's still We're still here. We're still alive. They will deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens existed. The earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters, also the world of that time was dislodged and destroyed during the time of Noah. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire. There's going to be a judgment being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of who? Ungodly men. Do not forget this one thing, dear friends. Look at how strong Peter's words were. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. And 1,000 years are like a day. Maybe during the time of Peter, there were scoffers already. And I believe during our time right now, even more scoffers, mocking Christians, mocking the word of God, mocking the coming of the second coming of Jesus, mocking the resurrection. They're saying that it's not real. No, it's not going to happen. Everything will be okay. Let's just believe that everything will, you know, be better as long as we love one another. It's good. They're promoting love, love, love. You will hear that all over the world. Let's just promote love, love, love. But you know the problem of that mindset? God is not in the picture. That's why, look at what Peter said. The Lord is not slow in keeping His promise. When He says something, He's going to fulfill it. As some understand slowness, He is patient with you. Maybe for some of you are listening, you haven't repented yet. You're not yet serious with God. And here is this passage for you. He is patient with you. He doesn't want anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Verse 10, it reads, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief." We don't know. It's going to surprise us. "The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire. The earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you or us be? You ought to live holy, godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat." I highlighted it on yellow because this is our role. Since God is sovereign, He's all powerful. Yes, there's going to be judgment. And yes, we have placed our faith in Him. If we have genuinely placed our faith in Him, then we ought to live holy, godly lives. And we ought to look forward to the day of God, His return. In verse 13 it reads, "But in keeping with His promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of the righteous people," the righteousness. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with God. You know, during this quarantine, this pandemic, one of the things that God rebuked me with is it seems like I'm looking forward more to the vaccine and cure, to the quarantine being lifted off, lockdown being lifted off, everything going back to normal. It seems like I'm longing for that more than longing for Christ's return. And I have to be honest with you, I really got convicted. Because Peter was right. If we are in Christ and we have placed our faith in Him, then we should be more, we should long more for His return. We should look forward with excitement, with anticipation that He is returning soon. If we are in Christ, then we should long more for that rather than long more for what the world offers. You see, a lot of Christians, a lot of people are still holding on in this world, holding on in their career, holding on their accomplishments, holding on their plans, their dreams, going abroad, doing many things, graduating and stuff like that. I mean, it's not wrong to dream dreams here on earth. But I pray that those dreams will not be our main thing. I pray that we will long more for God's return than long more to accomplish those dreams. I pray that we will desire more that Jesus Christ comes again than desire more to have fun and enjoy these worldly pleasures. Because just like Peter, he is longing and looking forward to the coming of the Messiah. You know what I realize? Longing for his return will lead me to passionately proclaim his truth and love to others. No, seriously. If I long for the return of Christ, then I don't care if people will laugh at me if I'm a committed follower of Jesus or proclaim his word online or share the truth through chat, through Zoom. When I chat my friends about Jesus, share them about the resurrection and the life, I'm not going to be ashamed. It's okay for me because I know Jesus is returning again. And not just that, they need the truth. A lot of people in this world, they need Jesus. And God wants them not to perish, but to come to repentance. So let's summarize what we have learned. Number one, we need faith to please God. We need faith to be saved. And the object of our faith, number two, should be God, His Word, Jesus Christ. And number three, the test of our faith is complete obedience to God. If it's really genuine, it will lead us to obey and it will lead us to proclaim His word. So what is the application for you and for me? Let's read this passage. In 2 Corinthians 13:5, it reads, "Examine yourself to see whether you are in the faith." So Paul said this, "Test yourselves. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you? Unless, of course, you fail the test." So there's a test. There's a validation if someone is really a genuine follower of Jesus or not. That's why I mentioned in this series that we have, I mentioned, I think, in the first session, that maybe some of us here, we think we believe, but there's no proof. There's no evidence. We don't see love for the Lord, or you don't see love for the Lord. You don't see love for other people. You don't see obedience. You haven't been letting go of that sin. It's still there and you don't want to let it go. Or maybe it's a really, really bad situation or evil practice that until now you're doing and you know that God is not honored. I'm not saying you're not saved. But just like this question of Paul, we need to test ourselves. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you? Unless, of course, you fail the test. So how do you recognize that Jesus Christ is in you? Or what evidences manifest His being in you? Look at these questions. You don't need to answer this right now, but I want you to reflect on these questions. First, do I have a passion to please God? Do I have this desire to honor the Lord? Number two, do you sincerely try to avoid sin? We're not going to be perfect here on earth. But we will slowly less and less sin. But do you sincerely try to avoid it? Or there's no avoidance. It's just normal, dude. This is what I want. And I'm going to do this regardless if God says no. Regardless if this is not what God wants. Third question. Are you hungry for God's word? Do you read His word? Do you meditate on it? Do you try to memorize the scriptures? Number four, do you have a heartfelt desire to obey God? A desire, to, again, same with question number one, to please the Lord, to obey Him because you love Him. Number five, is God not something else, the only object of your faith? I want you to be honest when you answer these questions. Because again, if you don't have genuine faith yet, then I pray that tonight will be that night or today will be that day that you give your life to Him and you believe Him with all your heart. Genuine kind of faith. I'm going to close with this story. You know, my son loves to play Lego. And when he plays Lego, so I'm the one who builds the Lego for him because he's 6 years old. Or when the first time I bought him a Lego, he was around 2.5 years old. So I'm the one who builds the Lego and then I give it to him and he plays with it. And every time he plays with it, usually he breaks it. And then he gets frustrated because it's not like the one I gave to him. So he's going to bring it back to me because he believes and he trusts that I can fix it. And I'm able to fix it. I have the guide. I understand what the guide is all about. I understand how to look at the steps, and I'll be able to fix it, and I'll give it back to him. So every time he plays with it and breaks it, he goes back to me and trusts and believes that I'll be able to fix it. Why am I saying that story? You see, my son has faith in me that I'll be able to do this. It's a simple kind of illustration of someone believing in someone. And because of his belief, he always goes to me. And he's excited that I'm fixing it. And he's anticipating that I'm going to give it to him. In fact, when he breaks the Lego or the Lego piece or the Lego set, and then I'm not at home, he's excited that he knows I'm going to go home. And he will go to me and tell me, "Daddy, I broke the Lego. Could you help me fix it?" So he's excited. He knows the time. Oh, Daddy's about to go home. Daddy's about to go home. And when I'm home, he shows me the broken Lego set, and then I'm able to fix it. You see, we need to have that kind of childlike faith in the Lord. My son doesn't understand how I fix things, how I fix this. During that time, right now he's learning more. He knows how to build it. But during that time, he doesn't understand. He doesn't understand how all of these things operate. But he just believes that I'm able to fix it. You see, that's that childlike faith that God wants us to have in the Lord Jesus Christ. We don't know how everything works around in this world. There's so many things we couldn't explain. I mean, just like now, we cannot explain coronavirus. No scientist or doctor can fully comprehend what this virus is all about. And not just this virus, but so many other things in this world. That's why we need to put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And all we need to be reminded of is the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we have that Resurrection Sunday. Because it brings us back to the reality that, hey, wait a minute. There's only one person who predicted his death and resurrection and was able to pull it off. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Why wouldn't I put my faith on him if he died and rose again? And nobody has ever done that. Why wouldn't you do it? So if you're that person, and God is convicting your heart right now to put your faith in him, genuine faith, to really believe, belief that leads to obedience. Why don't we all bow down our heads and let's close this time, and I want to pray for you. So if you're that person and you want to place your faith in Jesus, genuine faith in Jesus, say something like this. You say, "Jesus, I'm really sorry for all my sins. I'm sorry that I have been living my life for my own and for myself and for my pleasure. Jesus, today I humble myself. I acknowledge that you are God. I acknowledge that you are my Savior. So today, with all my heart, I receive you, Jesus, as my Lord and my Savior. Please come into my life. Change me. From now on, I will follow you. Please help me obey you every single day of my life. Thank you for your gift of eternal life. I love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen." If you have prayed that prayer, we would like to get to know you more. So I pray that you chat us. If you're not yet part of a small group, we highly encourage you to join one, because we want you to continue growing in your walk with the Lord. Before we end, let's read our memory verse for today. It's found in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Let's read this together. "And without faith, it is impossible to please God, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him." Let's put our faith in the Lord in every area of our life. So thank you for listening today. May God bless you. May you all be safe and continue to be healthy. So God bless you guys.